Tim, you run several blogs and online magazines. How has COVID-19 impacted your journalism work? And are you pivoting? And if so, how?
Yeah, so I have different sites that cover different aspects, and they've not declined equally. They're all down, that's for sure. But Perceptive Travel is all kind of narrative, let's say armchair travel kind of stories anyway. So that one has not declined as much as one I run that's called Hotel Scoop, which is basically all about hotels and, you know, has reviews of property, and nobody's researching hotels or making bookings right now. So that one's down about 75%. I think the other ones are down anywhere from 25 to 50%, which is still terrible, but, you know, it's not the end of the world. What's hurt more is a lot of the advertising has declined along with it, because even if my traffic were the same, revenue would have gone down just because a lot of the advertising has pulled out in the travel world for good reasons. I mean, if you run a cruise company or a hotel chain, why are you going to advertise right now? It doesn't make much sense. And we had a lot of direct ad programs that got put on hold or got canceled because, you know, for the same reason. It's just, we even had a few that we voluntarily paused because we just said to the client, you know, this doesn't make any sense right now. Nobody can make a booking with you and actually act on it. So it doesn't make sense for us to keep your ads running. Let's take them down and we'll just give you that back later as the equal amount of time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there has been a decline there, although we do have some coming in. So I'm feeling a little more fortunate than some. I also have some books out, and people are reading more, I think, these days. So book sales are doing okay, even though one of them is purely a travel book. But another one I have is about living abroad, and I think a lot of people are still doing planning about that, especially if they're looking at their nest egg, their IRA balance or whatever, their 401k. They're thinking, maybe I don't have as much to retire on as I thought I did. And then I didn't do a whole lot of freelancing, so I feel more fortunate than people that were full-time freelancers, because there's just not much of a market out there for travel stories right now. So you pretty much have to pivot to writing about something else if you're a freelancer. And on that count, I've been pivoting the same way on most of my blogs, trying to do things that are sort of related to travel but are not directly travel stories, because I don't think it makes a lot of sense right now to do the service kind of articles, especially. Why are you going to do a go here, see that, stay here kind of article? Sure. Because nobody can really act on it. And we could tell people till we're blue in the face, oh, use this for planning, you know, dream and travel later. But honestly, people just can't get their head around that right now, because they don't even know when it's possible to go traveling again. So on my Latin America site, I always did rum reviews and tequila reviews and some other things that were kind of tangentially related, some real estate stories. So I've been doing more of that, especially on the blog part of it, and slowed down the amount that we're publishing on the magazine side. It's an online magazine, so we can just scale back and not put out as many new articles. And then on my Perceptive Travel online magazine, I actually have been running a retrospective issue instead of commissioning new stories, because it just financially doesn't make sense for me to lay out, you know, $500 each month if there's nobody traveling. So I'm trying to just highlight some older stories, because we've got 14 years worth of them. So I might as well get some eyeballs on some older stories. And so some things like that, doing more food and drink kind of pieces, and living abroad kind of stories.
Tim, on a personal level, with a home in the States and a home in Mexico, how do you see COVID-19 impacting your ability to travel between your homes?
Yeah, it's a timely question, because I'm actually trying to get a refund for a flight that I have next month, because I don't think, A, that I'm going to be able to go, and B, it's on Interjet, which is currently not flying internationally and is in financial trouble. So I'm kind of concerned. Normally I would just say, whatever, I'll take the credit, which I did that on an American flight last month. But this one, I'm kind of worried that the airline is not even going to be around. So that has affected me personally. My wife and I were both going to go up there at the end of May, back to Tampa Bay, which is where my home base is there. I don't have any rental property there or a house that I own, but my mother-in-law lives there. So we stay with her these days. And that's actually where my daughter is camped out at the moment. She's in university and she's doing all her classes online. So she's staying with my mother-in-law. But yeah, I don't know if both of us are going to go back or one of us is going to go back, but eventually we have to return to the U.S. because my daughter's moving out of her apartment and we were supposed to go help her. That's the end of June. So I'm hoping by then we'll be able to move around, but really, who knows at this point?
Now, on the professional front, particularly with media trips and those sorts of things where we've often crossed paths, how do you see COVID-19 impacting that realm as we look forward?
Yeah, it's interesting. I don't think we know how travel period is going to play out once we can move around, but I do think there will probably be fewer group trips and people will be traveling more in very small groups or as a family or as a couple or solo. And I think press trips are by nature group trips most of the time. You know, you put 10 or 12 people in a van and drive them around. And I don't know if that's going to make a whole lot of sense here in the, at least in the near term. So you might see more travel journalists invited individually, and maybe they stay longer and produce more content. And I kind of prefer to travel that way anyway, but a lot of times for the destination, it makes a lot more sense for them cost-wise to bring a whole bunch of people in as a group and shuttle them around. So I think there'll have to be some adjustments there. And maybe for a year, those destinations are not going to have much of a budget to work with anyway. So I think we're going to see a lot more people covering their own backyard.
Until the time that we're able to travel again, how are you keeping engaged? I mean, what are you doing to satisfy your wanderlust at this time?
It's difficult. I got to say, we all kind of have travel in our blood, you know, and otherwise we would be doing something else for a living and wouldn't have gone on so many trips. So yeah, it's difficult. I'm trying to, keep exposed to other places through the media. And I at least live in an interesting place that still kind of feels exotic. You know, it's not where I grew up. It's not, it doesn't look anything like the United States. So even though I'm not that far as a plane ride, you know, a couple hours away from Texas, but it feels like a whole nother world. So that at least helps for me. I think if I were still kicking back in downtown Tampa where I lived before, I'd be getting a lot more antsy.
But you have the water there, so.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you have beaches and whatever in Florida, but they're not open, most of them. Here we are surrounded by mountains, so that's kind of nice. I have been doing some hiking here and there because I can basically just go uphill 10 minutes and be in nature. So I can do that without encountering many people and easily staying 6 feet away from them. And so that's one thing that has helped here. I can at least get outside and get around. I feel sorry for people that are in the middle of a huge city because it's much more difficult.
Yeah, I'd say, I mean, here in DC, I have concrete to look at out my window. So you touched on this just a second ago about the future of travel, certainly for travel journalists, but for the regular public, for, you know, regular travelers, what, you have any thoughts on what travel is going to look like for the average traveler post-coronavirus?
Well, I think if you take away the outliers in the mix, most people are probably not going to completely feel safe until there's widespread testing and maybe even some kind of vaccine or cure. But I think without the testing, which they have implemented in a lot of other countries like China and Korea, you know, you can't go anywhere without getting your temperature taken and, you know, you're tested constantly. I think if we get to that point, then people will feel okay about traveling around. But I think they're still going to be pretty leery about getting on a packed airplane or a packed bus. And there's going to be more car travel, I think, than anything at first, or RV travel even. Those kinds of things will probably feel safer to people. I don't think we'll have big festivals and concerts and sporting events for quite a while, because it just seems too risky. Even the countries that are getting over it aren't really talking about that yet.
Sure.
Given where we are right now with the COVID-19 situation, what suggestions do you have to the individual to keep travel alive in their lives?
Yeah, I think we all have access to 1,000 times more media choices than we had in the old days when the three of us were youngsters. So
I think
it's easy to go traveling from your living room these days, through TV shows and podcasts and books and everything else, and you have them at your fingertips electronically, even without getting a delivery. So I think that's a pretty safe way to go out and see the world. We've been drowning in content ever since the internet started, so I don't think anybody's hurting for choices, and no matter how narrow their area may be that they want to focus on, you can find videos and TV shows about pretty much any corner of the globe now. So I think while we wait, that's probably the best way to vicariously live your travel life.
Before we go, I want to ask you, if you could sit next to anyone, past or present, on a long-haul flight, who would that be?
Well, I think present, it would probably be Tim Ferriss, the author, because I've read all his books and listened to his podcast, and I think he's an intelligent guy, but even more importantly, he's interviewed 1,000 intelligent people, so it would be a good conversation and be something interesting. And from the past, I think I'd love to take a ride with Leonardo da Vinci. That would be an interesting conversation as well.